Finland is getting ready to join NATO, and that is a problem for Russia. The western portion of the Kola Peninsula is packed with nuclear weapons and military facilities. The bulk of Russia's strategic bombers are kept here, parked neatly in air bases along this stretch of land. Yet all that firepower, deterrence, and power projection is held in place by a single parallel road and rail corridor, which runs for about 700 kilometers before it forks. Yeah, if Finland joins NATO, it would transform the security climate in Northern Europe and the Baltic region. The corridor running through the Kola Peninsula would transform into a strategic choke point. A NATO-backed surprise attack on Russia could derail the supply chains between Moscow and Murmansk. Like in Ukraine, a company of specialists could sabotage the infrastructure and cripple Russia's nuclear capabilities. There is no defense against this vulnerability. The geography doesn't allow it. The peninsula is brimming with pine forests, the perfect hunting ground for special forces. Finland joining NATO would essentially crush Russia's nuclear readiness, turn the Baltic Sea into a NATO lake, and drive Moscow into bankruptcy. The irony is that before the war, policymakers were calling for the Finlandization of Ukraine. Now, they are calling for the Ukrainization of Finland. Today's video is sponsored by Masterworks. There is a lot ongoing in the world. A poll by Pew Research Center shows that most Americans see inflation as the biggest issue facing the country, far exceeding other concerns. Parallel punishment is what the experts call it when inflation and global crisis strike at the same time. But amid chaos, there is also opportunity. The global fintech market is expected to grow by 20% over the next 4 years. There's a ton of innovation in this space. My personal fintech platform is Masterworks, which offers a unique asset, contemporary art. Here's the rundown. Contemporary art prices outpaced the S&P 500 total return by 164% from 1995 to 2021. Meanwhile, Deloitte projects the total wealth held in art to grow by $900 billion by 2026. Using Masterworks, retail investors like myself can own a slice of Banksy and Picasso, whose paintings have sold with over 30% net internal rate of return to their investors. Now, past performance is no guarantee for future results, but 30% is pretty impressive. If you want to join other Caspian Report subscribers, use the link in the description to skip the waitlist and get started on Masterworks. The Finnish-Russian relationship is a product of history. In 1809, the polity, now known as Finland, was carved out of conquered Swedish territory by the Russian Empire. Tsarist rule subjected the territory to repression and forced assimilation, and it wasn't until the Russian Revolution of 1917 that Finland broke off to become fully independent. Helsinki maintained stable relations with Soviet Russia throughout the 1920s, yet Joseph Stalin, a realist geopolitical thinker, saw Finland as merely a buffer that shielded Imperial Russia. And after consolidating his leadership in the late 1930s, he sought to take it back. What followed were three distinct armed conflicts that shaped Finland to its core. The first was the Winter War of late 1939. Under the cover of a Nazi-Soviet non-aggression pact, Stalin invaded Finland but was soon forced to accept limited territorial gains in exchange for peace with Helsinki. Later, when Nazi Germany invaded Soviet Russia in 1941, Finland joined the attack, recovering its territories, gaining new ones in East Karelia, and facilitating the siege of Leningrad. Eventually, though, the tide turned against Berlin, and Helsinki and Moscow agreed to peace on condition that Finland concede Petsamo and denazify its territory. Thereafter, the Finns expelled Germany in what became known as the Lapland War. These conflicts left neither side embellished, yet the post-war settlement achieved a surprisingly stable peace. The Finno-Soviet Treaty of 1948 ensured a militarily neutral Finland, giving Stalin the buffer he wanted. While for Helsinki, the deal preserved its democracy and kept it out of the Warsaw Pact. By sitting on the diplomatic fence, Finland maintained good relations with the West and economic cooperation with the East in what became known as Finlandization. This policy persisted even after the Soviet collapse in 1991. Unlike the Baltic states, Helsinki refused NATO membership, instead pursuing limited integration by joining the alliance's Partnership for Peace program. And though Finland participated in NATO interventions in Afghanistan and Libya, its Russia policy remained benign. In the wake of the Russo-Georgian War of 2008, Finland's prime minister even stated that the lesson of the conflict was that Helsinki should seek closer ties with Moscow. Nevertheless, cooperation between Finland and NATO deepened. For years, all Finnish military procurements have met NATO standards, ensuring the interoperability of forces. The critical difference is that Finland is not shielded by Article 5, meaning there is no obligation for NATO members to come to Finland's aid should it be attacked. Helsinki understands that this provision is a third rail issue for Moscow, and for this reason, Finns have historically opposed NATO membership as being provocative and unnecessary. Russia's invasion of Ukraine in February 2022 changed this dynamic. Helsinki and Stockholm condemned the attack, and for the first time, Helsinki began to discuss NATO membership seriously. This stance reflected public opinion. Approval of NATO membership prior to the Ukraine invasion stood at only 20%, but afterwards this number soared to 70%. This was followed on April 13 by a government report that stated the country's security arrangements were insufficient. Finland's parliament is currently debating the issue, and an application for NATO membership is now expected in mid-May. Within a few weeks, decades of Finnish neutrality unraveled. Should Helsinki apply for NATO membership, a rapid ascension is likely. The ratification period would be dangerous as Finland would not yet be under Article 5. Washington has therefore offered support to Helsinki during the transition period. German Chancellor Olaf Scholz has supported the move, while NATO's former Secretary General has said that Finland's membership could be approved overnight at the alliance's headquarters. That said, not everyone is thrilled to welcome Sweden and Finland into NATO. Croatia, Hungary, and Greece are some of the nations that could veto NATO expansion. However, the biggest obstacle comes from Turkey, NATO's southern front. Finland and Sweden are major sponsors of the YPG and the PYD, whose parent organization is the infamous PKK. Hundreds of millions of dollars of Finnish and Swedish taxpayer money is directly and indirectly sent to groups that seek to harm Turkey's population. This self-defeating relationship is the work of special lobbying groups within Finland and Sweden, but it bears no geopolitical value for Stockholm or Helsinki. Without much hassle, they could drop the PKK relationship and reassure Turkey. So, some last-minute horse trading is necessary to reach a consensus within NATO. In any event, most are expecting Finland to be offered NATO membership before the alliance's Madrid conference in June. Excitement for Finnish membership is not solely due to its proximity to Russia. Finland packs a heavy punch, and unlike some NATO members, it would be a contributor to the alliance, not just a user. The country's intelligence capabilities are substantial, and its armed forces are bolstered by mandatory national service. Helsinki can raise 280,000 troops and 900,000 reserves out of a population of 5.6 million, making it one of the largest militaries relative to size. Finland also has more battle tanks than Germany and an air force of 64 F-18s armed with US-supplied smart missiles, and with an additional 64 new F-35 jets to be delivered beginning in 2026. Furthermore, the country has a strong navy, and its participation in other NATO operations means that it is fully interoperable with the alliance. Finland is also prepared at the civilian level. There are more than 5,000 bomb shelters in Helsinki and an extensive subway system, which contains amenities and a 2-week supply of food. Still more, pharmaceutical companies are required by law to have at least 3 months' worth of imported prescription drugs on hand, while national strategic stockpiles have supplies for 6 months, including fuel and grain. Helsinki also has an informal network of political, financial, and cultural institutions. So, much like in Israel, society can be turned into crisis mode when needed. Banks, media outlets, and industries like telecoms, food suppliers, and energy firms know what to do in times of trouble. Meanwhile, a poll by Gallup International shows that 74% of Finns are willing to fight for their country, one of the highest figures in Europe. To foreigners, these measures may seem excessive, but for Finns, sweating more in peacetime means bleeding less in wartime. On a regional level, Finland joining NATO would fundamentally alter Northern Europe's security architecture, especially if Sweden follows Finland into the alliance. Like Finland, Sweden was rattled by Russia's invasion of Ukraine. According to recent polls, a majority of Swedes support NATO membership, and as such, Stockholm is also looking at joining NATO. Such an addition would change the strategic landscape considerably. Sweden's Gripen fighters, when added to the F-35s of Norway, Denmark, and Finland, would amount to a force totaling more than 250 advanced fighter jets, forcing the Russians to adjust their strategic posturing and stretch their military deterrence thinly. Moreover, Swedish airspace and the possibility of a military base on Gotland would have tremendous power projection capabilities. It would strengthen NATO's grip on the Baltic states. Converting the Baltic Sea into a NATO lake would also reduce the vulnerabilities associated with the Suwalki Gap and create greater EU-NATO integration and burden sharing, allowing Washington to finally turn its attention to the security competition in Asia-Pacific. Should the Baltic Sea turn into a NATO lake, it would incapacitate the Russian Navy with no relief in sight. Here's what's at stake. Russia operates the world's largest fleet of submarines, but these subs mainly rely on the Baltic Sea for free passage to the Atlantic, which is the only way to bypass American undersea sonars. Currently, Russian submarines sail outside the territorial waters of Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania right up to the Danish Straits. If Finland and Sweden join NATO, the passage for navigation would become too narrow for Russian submarines to move undetected. As NATO members, Finland and Sweden would share all naval intelligence with fellow member states. NATO would be able to track the movement of Russian submarines. No more hiding. And stealth really is the whole purpose of submarine strategy. So, as ineffective as the Russian Navy is, its combat readiness would be slashed in half should NATO expand further into Scandinavia. Finland and Sweden are the missing links to this strategy. So, should they join NATO, it would be a game changer. And that is precisely the problem. No matter how justified Finland may be in seeking NATO membership, the consequences of antagonizing Russia are real and must be reckoned with. Moscow's nuclear facilities on the Kola Peninsula are the crux of Russian power and missile defense in the Western Arctic. The closed town of Severomorsk on the Barents Sea forms the headquarters of Russia's Northern Fleet. Moscow has spent the past decade modernizing the base. And as climate change opens new shipping lanes in the Arctic, the Severomorsk facility will only become more integral to Russian power projection. The nearby Plisetsk Cosmodrome is also home to missile systems such as RS-24 ICBMs, which are capable of delivering nuclear payloads across a range of 10,000 kilometers. Going by nuclear weapons, the western portion of the Kola Peninsula is arguably the most densely packed area on the planet. But it gets crazier. The same region also has the most extensive collection of air bases belonging to the Russian Air Force, including assets such as the Tu-160 Blackjack, the Tu-122N Blackfire, and the Tu-95 Bear. The bulk of these long-range strategic bombers is located in the western part of the Kola Peninsula. In fact, all the air bases sit methodically along a single vertical corridor. That sounds neat and all, but there's one problem. The entire Kola Peninsula is connected to the rest of Russia by one road and one railroad, with each running for about 700 kilometers before they fork. Yeah, it's that imprudent. All this firepower, deterrence, and power projection is held in place by a parallel road and rail corridor. If you thought Russian logistics was bad in Ukraine, think again. The corridor going into the Kola Peninsula is a strategic choke point. If Finland joins NATO, the danger could come from anywhere along the Finnish border. The terrain in the Kola Peninsula is densely packed with pine forests, the perfect hunting ground for special forces. A company of specialists could sabotage the road and rail infrastructure going across the Kola Peninsula, crippling Russia's nuclear capacity. Like in northern Ukraine, when a 65-kilometer Russian convoy was ground to a halt, one does not need to occupy territory to sabotage logistics. Not even stationing a million soldiers would make a difference in the Kola Peninsula. NATO could strike from anywhere along Finland's border at any time. This is not a gamble Russia can afford to lose. Any such attempt to challenge Moscow's dominance in the region would be construed as a direct affront to Russian power. So much like Norway's experience, Helsinki will probably not allow permanent NATO bases or nuclear weapons on its territory for fear of provoking Moscow. However, the mere act of Finland joining NATO would more than double Russia's border with the alliance, imposing a heavy financial burden on Moscow at a time when its economy is hurting under sanctions. The Kremlin could retaliate through hybrid warfare and cyber attacks. It could also terminate Finland's lease on the Saima Canal, which connects industrial centers on Lake Saima with European markets. Doing so would increase the costs of exporting Finnish timber, paper, fertilizers, and cargo. But these maneuvers are unlikely to stop Helsinki from joining NATO. Ultimately, though, in a conflict scenario, Moscow's fallback would be the nuclear option. This view was made clear by former Russian Prime Minister Dmitry Medvedev, who stated that Finnish and Swedish NATO membership would mark the end of a nuclear-free Baltic region. For the moment, though, the main front is the propaganda war. Official pronouncements have played up the chances of conflict, with Finland being a flashpoint for World War III. Should Russo-Finnish relations deteriorate further, Putin may seek to draw upon Finland's collaboration with Nazi Germany during World War II. Doing so would bolster his propaganda narrative that the objective of the current conflict is to denazify Russia's frontiers. But this would do little to change the situation on the ground. All up, Finland joining NATO would fundamentally change the geopolitical calculus in the Baltics. It would open a new front in the ongoing clash between Russia and the West, a clash that would intensify should Sweden follow Finland into NATO. The forces of politics are intractable. They often lead small nations into dangerous, unknown territory. Helsinki clearly favors the West, Whether Russia will accept this fact peacefully is not so obvious. As in the past, Finland is caught in a situation not of its own making, and in times of war, standing aside is also considered a choice. Helsinki may prefer to keep its hands clean, but no one can stay neutral on a moving train. I've been your host Shirvan from Caspian Report. Special thanks to Anton Murrell for researching this topic. And as usual, if you like what we do, please leave a like, share, and subscribe. Thank you for watching, and Sahol.